Good morning, everyone. No good morning?
Good morning. Oh, yeah.
That's the old teacher in me. I can't help it. Thank you all for coming this morning. We wanted to spend a few minutes today talking to you about some of Southampton's sustainability programs. And our Councilman Bouvier is going to give you some more detail, but I wanted to give you a brief introduction. I want to also welcome members of our Sustainability Committee. Both of the chair and co-chair are here, Dieter and Glorian. I want to welcome one of our trustees and members of the community and members of the press. Just by way of brief introduction, I don't think I need to share with you too much information about why sustainability and trying to reduce your carbon footprint is an important issue, but I did want to share three kind of startling facts. One is that I read the other day that this past January, was the warmest January on record in the world. Pretty startling statistic. And many of us have probably read about the melting glaciers on Greenland, which I think have contributed several billion gallons of water to the world's oceans. Yesterday I read something which really caught my attention, and maybe some of you read it. In the country of Iceland, they mounted a plaque and a monument to a place where a glacier used to be, but no longer is. And on that plaque, they wrote in a section called Letter to the Future, "This monument is an acknowledgement that we know what is happening, and we know what needs to be done. Only you, people of the future, will know if we were successful." But we don't need dramatic facts like that. For those of us who live in a beautiful community like this, and I don't want to neglect to mention this beautiful marina is a town facility operated by our Parks Department, and they do an outstanding job. I live on a road that ends at the eastern end of Shinnecock Bay. At the end of that road, it's now 10 feet shorter than it was when I was a young boy and used to bicycle down there to go fishing for snapper on this time of year. That road was occasionally impassable due to flooding. Maybe a rare storm in early September, but certainly not the regular occurrence that it is now, 5, 6, 7, 8 times a year, often only during lunar tides. When there happens to be a rainfall, there'll be 6 or 8 inches of the road, and a good 50% of the road is impassable. I can attest to that because a member of my family, who shall remain nameless, lost a vehicle in one of those flooded areas on our road. But with that information, the more dramatic global information and the impacts that we experience locally, we can no longer afford to simply be stewards of the environment. It's a luxury we don't have anymore. We really need to be soldiers for the environment. And think of it as conducting warfare against the forces that are deteriorating our Earth and almost eliminating our habitat. But the good news is that we are, in fact, armed to conduct that warfare. You and I and all of our neighbors are better equipped to conduct that warfare. We have emerging technologies like the one that's on exhibition today with this little electric-powered boat. And it evidences the fact that technologies like this are integrating into all aspects of our life. They've become more accessible, they've become more prevalent, and certainly become more noticeable. On that same street that I talked to you about before, that many years ago when I used to fish at the end of the road, there wasn't a single home that had solar paneling. 10 years ago, there was one. This morning as I left, I counted. There are a dozen homes with solar paneling on the roof. There's even a neighbor of mine who recently built a large home that is completely geothermal cooling and heating. Something that no one would have thought of 5 years ago. Probably no one would have thought of even 2 years ago. But these are dramatic changes that are having a real impact on the environment. We're also benefiting from the fact that, aside from a spirited and active community organization like our Sustainability Committee, we have a very talented and dedicated staff. one of whom is represented here today. She's hiding somewhere. There she is, Christine Fenton, whose department, Department of Municipal Works, oversees the Sustainability Division and is a direct link to the Sustainability Committee. More importantly, we have town leadership that helps us initiate these programs and endorses those tools that we can now use to help protect our environment. I'm going to baptize Mr. Bouvier as the educator-in-chief on the town board, because it's through John's expertise and his commitment to the environment that many of our board members support various programs and initiatives that have been part of the town's history for the past 10 years that I've worked in town hall. More importantly, though, as important as John's leadership is, each and every policy and program that the town board has been adopted unanimously. That means all five members of that board voted for that program. And over the years, and even now, those boards are very diverse. They come to these policies and decisions from very different perspectives, but they all come to common ground and make a unanimous decision about how we should proceed forward and the kinds of programs that would be available to you, members of the community, to help you reduce your carbon footprint and retain the beauty of the environment like the one we have behind us today. I did tell you that my comments would be brief. They're already longer than I anticipated. So I want to just take this opportunity to thank you again all for coming and to introduce Mr. Bouvier, who's going to give you a little bit more detail than I was able to do in the short time. John?
I, on the other hand, won't be so brief. And thank you, Frank, very much for that. You reminded me of a moment in my life when I was young. I was in Switzerland, and there was a ladder, a metal ladder, sort of stuck into a cliff face. And I was trying to understand why it was just sort of stuck there and what the purpose of it was. And apparently, some 30 years before that, there had been a glacier there that tourists would climb down and walk onto that ladder. And that ladder had been abandoned by that glacier. The glacier had melted away, and it was largely the water that feeds Lake Geneva. And I got a long explanation by a tour leader at the time who told me this story. And, you know, we've in many ways known that we're reaching this point. We've known that for some time and have turned a deaf ear to it on a number of occasions. I'm particularly excited to be a member of this board, where we work very well with our Sustainability Committee, who are constantly working and passionate about what they believe in and bring that to the board. And I'm glad to play a small role in trying to get some of these initiatives passed, which I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to use a quote that Lynn Arthur, our energy chair, seems to like, and I think I understand why. This was a quote from Trevor Nace. He's a senior contributor to Forbes magazine. And he says, as we continue to see Earth change and notice our local communities change, we are forced to both adjust to the new normal and take a step back to evaluate how and if we will play a role as stewards on this planet. And that's significant to me, because this is telling me that a whole nother industry and a whole nother community has taken notice of something that's really important, that's near and dear to our hearts. But more importantly than that, we're reaching a crisis point that we have to react to. So as a community, I work with these great people here to bring these initiatives in place, and I'm very confident that we can achieve a lot of these goals. And one of them is reducing our dependence on fossil fuels. So as you said, Frank, July was the hottest month. January is the hottest month. Well, this past July was also the hottest month on record since we've been taking temperature measurements since 1880. That's when we started doing that. So just recently, we've reached an important point, and as you pointed out, 12 billion tons of ice have melted off of the Greenland glaciers in 24 hours. That's significant. So what we're seeing are these things that are now becoming evident to us, and as you look out and you talk to people who work and live on the water, they'll all tell you the same stories, that we're seeing changes in our tides and the encroachment of water, salt water intrusion into our aquifers, all the things that are effects of climate change and sea level rise. And locally, just this year, our local electric utility has called 3 curtailment events in the last 30 days because of a spike in demand for electricity due to when temperatures rise to 90 degrees, they're going to cut back the availability of electricity. We've experienced 3 of those in the last 30 days. You know, that's significant as well. So according to the IPCC, which is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, ice melts generates rising sea levels, which increases the frequency and severity of storms, ocean acidification, and irreversible loss of ecosystems. So ocean acidification is really, when we talk about emissions, we talk about carbon dioxide in our air. When that penetrates water, it creates gas. It's the same reason why your kids tell you don't drink carbonated drinks. Well, that's one of the reasons, because it makes it acid, and that's what's happening to our ocean. The thing that we need to watch is the rate of change. So we've been told, you know, you have sea level rise, we're going to 6 inches here and another 6 inches there, but it's increasing at a growing rate, and we need to watch that, and that's what's really driving a lot of our concerns and your concerns and the concerns that we share. And hundreds of scientists agree if global warming exceeds 1.5 degrees Celsius before returning to that level by 2100, then our ecosystems will be lost. Ocean acidification and sea level rise may have hit a point of no return. And it's not a can we can keep kicking down the road. We have to do it now. Locally, severe storms cause beach erosion, rising temperatures, they impact plant, bird, fish, and animal habitats. Probably some of you have noticed insects that you've never seen before in your yards. You've noticed that a lot of leaves are growing larger than they normally do. These are all sort of these subtle signs of things that are happening around us. And we go, oh, that's interesting, but we really need to understand why that's happening and what can we do to protect our coastlines and this beautiful community that we live in and be part of a global effort to reduce carbon emissions and to find alternative ways to not use fossil fuels, which are the general producer of those emissions. Locally, severe storms cause beach erosion, rising temperatures. Oh, did I say that? I'm sorry. And generate increasing needs for air conditioning. Ocean acidification affects our fishing industry. On the South Fork, we are particularly affected because the environment is not only our economy, but it's also our quality of life. While Southampton enjoys the highest possible credit rating of AAA by Moody's, and now that's when we go as a municipality to borrow money, our credit rating affects how much interest we pay. So when you go to borrow, just like you go to your bank, we go to a bank to borrow money to do things, and we want to enjoy a good credit rating because we can borrow that money at less money. So Moody's is, our rating in Southampton is AAA. It's the highest that Moody gives, and it's been verified by an independent outside auditor. But the interesting part to that is that future financial risk assessments will likely consider municipalities' plans and investments in mitigating climate risk factors. The recent addition of a company that Moody's acquired called 427 enhances their growing portfolio of risk standards for assessing environmental and climate risk factors. 427 also strengthens Moody's growing thought leadership and research on incorporating climate risk into modeling and credit ratings. And what that really boils down to is that municipalities that recognize the issues that we're talking about today and react to them and invest in mitigating them enjoy a better credit rating than municipalities that don't. And that's important to continue to do the work that we're doing, our ability to borrow money, our grant posture, what we do, how we do those sorts of things. As an elected official, I feel it's our job to protect all of those things. Southampton is a coastal community of almost 300 square miles, half of which is water, and we are vulnerable to the loss of our coastlines, storm events, and our sole source water aquifer and our electrical infrastructure. So you guys may recall Sandy and what happened, and we've had more storms and more damage to our coastlines than probably most people realize. We have taxing districts which are trying to put sand back on their beaches, and this is a costly endeavor, but they're willing to do that to protect this community. But it can't go on forever. And so we have to look at things like raising homes or coastal retreat. We have to anticipate the coming future. So what has New York State done to increase energy independence? And we'll start with the state. The Governor Cuomo's clean energy standard is a commitment to an 80% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions over the 1990 levels by 2050, and also to source 50% of the state's electricity from renewable sources by 2030, with a proposed expansion to 70%. It also includes the generation of 9,000 megawatts of offshore wind by 2035 and 1,500 megawatts of energy storage by 2025. And energy storage is a big issue. Now, when we put our solar panels and we get power that's dependent on the environment, wind and sun in particular, it's important to know that when that wind stops and the sun goes down, we have energy that we need to store. And we have a little boat back here that Frank alluded to. It's sort of hidden down in there, but I would invite you to go. It's a boat powered by batteries, and we're going to talk a little bit about batteries in a bit. So what is Southampton? I'm sorry. So we are also, Southampton Town is also a climate smart community, climate smart communities is one of the New York State programs designed to assist municipalities to achieve these targets. And Southampton is one of two municipalities that has achieved bronze status. That's a big deal. And that's so much due to our staff and planning department and people like you who have initiated these projects that have led this to this point, which enables us to do more. The better we do, the more we can do better. So we've set targets. Our big target is to source 100% of electricity from renewable sources by 2025. You've probably heard of that as energy independence, our energy independence goal. That's what that means. And we've also set a goal to become carbon neutral by 2040. But we also lead by example. As an example, we've transitioned all 1,778 streetlights that consume 2 million kilowatts of hour per year to LEDs. We've converted them to LEDs, and we've saved the town 1 million kilowatt hours. It's approximately $268,000 annually. But it's also saved us in something you can't account for, and that's the gas emissions that would have resulted from those higher energy consuming streetlights. And that's equivalent every year to approximately 85,000 gallons of gasoline, the emissions of burning 85,000 gallons of gasoline. It's the equivalent to charging 96 million phones. That's a lot of power. So how do you value that? So we know what we save in energy consumption because our bills go down. But how do we measure what we're doing for our planet by reduction of gas emissions? Because the two are directly related. Reducing our emissions helps us do good for the planet, but also helps us economically. It seems to me it's a win-win in all respects. The town is replacing fleet vehicles with electric or hybrid vehicles as leases on town vehicles come up for renewal. We've established the first solar array on Tiana Beach Pavilion and have plans to do more, Christine, who has led this effort with tenacity, and I want to thank you for that. We've adopted the Community Choice Aggregation Enabling Legislation and selected a CCA administrator as a result of a competitive bid, and are proceeding down a path to seek an alternative provider for electricity from renewable sources at a lower price than what town residents are paying now. We're evaluating proposals currently to add solar to town buildings. We're applying for grant funding to remediate brownfield site and prepare for solar installation. The town's sustainability efforts are obviously driving up Moody's credit ratings, and Southampton's only source of water is the aquifer, at which is at risk of consequence of sea level rise. So all these things are related to each other in different ways, in some ways that are obvious and other ways that you might not think of logically, but they are. They're related, directly related. So on our programs and policies on our energy front, the Department of Municipal Works, under the direction of Christine here, oversees the town sustainability programs, as Frank had mentioned. We've had a program called Solarize Southampton and tripled the number of solar rooftop applications. An estimated 75% of the residents who attended our Tri-Energy presentation signed up for a free home energy audit. That's a lot of people. 75% of those people signed up to do that, and successfully. understood the relationship between efficiency of their homes and their ability to reduce their power bill and consumption, and thus reduce carbon emissions and do all those really, really good things that come out of doing these really good things. Our land management department was the first in New York State to establish more stringent HERS index for new construction. That's a rating on how efficient your house is. For new construction, on new residential homes greater than 4,500 square feet, they must meet an even more stringent target. This results in an efficiently built house, uses less energy to operate, and typically has rooftop solar or geothermal heating and cooling. We have fast-tracked residential solar permitting. We have passed law to allow for ground-based solar arrays. We have initiated the South Fork Commuter Connection that promotes further use of public transportation with three additional east and westbound trains with connecting shuttles. On the water quality front, we have created the Water Quality Improvement Plan, and through this CPF-funded program, Southampton residents within certain income brackets are eligible for advanced septic replacement rebates. Those are what are commonly referred to as IA systems. These are systems that mitigate or reduce the nitrogen that comes out of, and the nitrogen is the issue that we are all aware of that affects our bays and causes the algal blooms. And I might mention that this is now the second year that Southampton has had no brown tide. And now I'd like to think it's because of our programs, but I think it's really because of a change in attitude, a change in culture, that people are realizing that what they put on their lawns, what they flush down their toilets, is critical to preventing the problems that we have. But I should also say that Southampton, with our rebate program, has installed more IA systems than the county combined. And I'm very proud of that record. And we will continue to do that. We've approved $3.5 million for water quality projects, including $2.3 million for West Hampton Beach, additional funding for Mecox Bay, Shinnecock Bay, and Sag Harbor, and $391,000 for Lake Agwam and Mill Pond cleanup. And there are other applications pending in the wings. The next rounds are going out. And we have roughly $10 million, which is our portion of the 20% set aside for the water for CPF fund that we're using for these projects. And I got to give great credit to our CPF department, Lisa Combrick, and particularly Janice Shearer, who couldn't be here, who have worked so diligently and so hard in this program. And it's really wonderful to see. So what have been the results of our local efforts? Through 2019, the town has acquired interests or rights in 425 parcels, which encompass approximately 4,435 acres of land. We've established the Tiana Bayside Education Center in cooperation with the Cornell Cooperative Extension to promote aquaculture and estuary restoration programs, which are critical to bay cleanup, are critical to these issues, and are critical to even to gas reduction, emissions reductions, if you can make that connection in your head. If you can't, I'm happy to speak with you and show you the direct links from this to what we're talking about in energy-wise. We've limited the use of fertilizer through wetlands covenants. We've installed EV charging stations at town parking locations. PSEG has provided our planning department with a summary of Southampton electricity usage, and through 2017, our annual consumption has been flat and even decreasing. Now that's kind of interesting, because the graph that I used to see was a 45-degree angle, a projection of what we were going to consume, and now it's not this, it's actually a little bit of that. That's directly related to some of the things that we've just talked about. The reason is primarily because newer, more efficient houses are replacing old ones, and residents are investing in technology to generate and store their own electricity and improving the efficiency of their homes. Another factor, critically important, is called peak load. And I'm sure anybody who spent 5 minutes with Lynn will hear the words peak load in that ensuing conversation. Peak load occurs when temperatures are above 90 degrees and energy demand soars due mostly to pool pumps and air conditioners, and that makes sense. More than 5% of Southampton residents have solar now, as good as that statistic is, even if we covered every rooftop in the town of Southampton, it would only meet about 10% of our energy needs. So we have to look at other ways to generate energy. It's not one source, it's a multiple pronged approach to doing what we are trying to do. As a town, I'm sorry, the current solutions to address those needs are offshore wind and battery storage. But also, as a town, we are incentivized to explore local alternative production, such as tidal generation, waste gasification, and other electrical generation technologies. So it's more than just solar, it's more than just wind, it's more than just taking power off the grid. There are other ways that we can efficiently produce power in a responsible way. So let's talk a little bit about batteries. Is battery storage a real solution? Well, battery storage is reusable, it's affordable, it's available, and both a substitute and a complement to energy generation. So to explain that, battery storage can store excess capacity from solar or wind, and stored electricity is 100 dispatchable, meaning it's available on demand. So that's what I talked about earlier, that we can take that energy, store it for later use, and not just give it back or let it release as heat and we lose it forever. And battery technologies, and I am an engineer and I do work somewhat in this field, battery technologies are increasing exponentially in their efficiency. And there's always a downside to everything. The concern would be, what do we do with those batteries once they're not usable in cars? Well, we'll talk about that in a minute. Renewables are intermittent energy generation sources. Battery storage can be discharged into the grid when the sun isn't shining or the wind isn't blowing to stabilize the grid. Homeowners, in place of carbon-based emergency generators, those are the ones where you pull and it sputters up and smokes and belches smoke everywhere, it's fossil fuel-based. They can use battery storage instead of that during the times when a power outage is that they need. Homeowners can choose to buy electricity during off-peak via voluntary time use of rates and run their home on batteries during peak to save money on electric bills. Homeowners and small businesses can receive payments for services provided to the grid, such as peak shaving and capacity. Electrical vehicle production has increased exponentially globally. As battery technologies continue to develop, EV vehicle batteries are finding a second life in residential and other industries. So once that battery, it used to be you'd buy, like my Prius, sir, your battery is no longer doing, my range is cut down, they're going to take it out and replace it with another battery. Well, that battery still has great use and great life, and it can be used for your home to store batteries. I was telling Mark here that my Prius has an added feature that you can actually connect your house to your Prius and use your Prius as a generator during storm areas when you're off the grid. And people are thinking this way. And we have roughly 3 million batteries that are available for that exact use, for residential homes, local storage of wind and solar energy. And it's being done. This boat behind me, I suspect, was one of those batteries. BMW uses a company that battery for its i3. That battery ends up mostly in boats and other vehicle use for its second life, which can be 10 to 20 years. I'm always amazed by what determined and creative people can do. And this Southampton Town Administration, this town, is blessed with such talent exhibited here by both our staff and those that give of their time and skills, like these folks, in our committees to help us reach energy and environmental goals that are critical to the future. And you should be proud of the work you do. I know I am. I feel so lucky to walk in a room and hear these conversations and see this determination. We share a common goal and know that inaction is just not an option. I want to thank you all for your drive and time and devotion to our common cause, and these are just the first steps. I work, and I'm fortunate to work with a great board, a board that works together to meet these goals. Jay Schneiderman, our supervisor, looks at what we bring him, and questions deeply, as he should, and arrives at a conclusion that I think our other board members do, that these incentives are absolutely critical to the future. Julie Lostad, Councilwoman Lostad, has just introduced a styrofoam and straw ban. Tommy John Schiavone, Councilman Schiavone, has just introduced rideshare. And each person, each council person on their own, has this same sense of responsibility to our planet locally. So I just want to thank you all for coming and indulging me to talk about the things that I love the most. And I know that together we're going to accomplish these goals. And thank you very, very much for being here.
Thank you, John, and I won't keep you but a minute longer. I just want to extend a thank you to Victoria Gorman, who's sitting right here, one of the newest members of our Sustainability Committee, and her daughter. Where's your daughter hiding? There she is. Who helped bring that boat over here yesterday when it was equally as hot. And also want to thank Lynn for coordinating all of this. It's a great draw. You know, I just want to add briefly that John reminded me of something that I want to share with you. I've been coming out here for quite a long time, and when I used to commute with my family from the Bronx, we didn't quite have to take a stagecoach, but it was pre-Long Island Expressway, and we often entertained ourselves, myself and my older brother and sister, by singing songs in the car. And one of the songs we used to sing was "The ankle bone's connected to the thigh bone, and the thigh bone's connected to the knee bone." Well, that metaphor reminds me of the points that John was making. All of it's connected. All of the pieces fit together, and they have to go together for the body to function effectively. And for our environment to function effectively, we all have to do this together. Thank you very much for coming this morning. Victoria is going to give you a one-woman tour, and if you'd like to perhaps take a ride, is that doable? Or at least step into the little electric boat, it's available to you. Thank you once again. Oh, Anne, would you like to say a few words? I'm sorry. You faded into the background there, Anne. In a good way.
Thank you.
I was supposed to introduce you.
Oh, no worries.
It was John.
Hi, everybody. Anne Welker, Southampton Town Trustee. I just really want to take a moment first to acknowledge where we are today, standing on a very historic maritime site, the site of the Tupper Boathouse. And hopefully, with work and time and money, the money part's always important, one day that will be a testament to the maritime heritage of our town. I also want to acknowledge and take a moment to appreciate the collaboration that exists here today, the work of the Conscience Point Shellfish Hatchery, a group of community-minded individuals who are making a difference one oyster at a time. So thank you for that work. Also, the Sustainability Committee, with everything they're doing, just passionate and nonstop. It's so great. Also, Christine Fenton and her staff, the town board, but also CTV out here on a hot day making it all happen. So I'd like to take a moment just for you to look behind me in the background and note a couple things. It's a light wind today. It's a beautiful, warm day. But keep in mind that with our more frequent, more intense storms, this site is not always this beautiful. The water frequently comes over the top of the bulkhead. And if you look across to the, in storms, if you look across to the other shoreline, you'll see a couple different examples of shoreline. And I'd like to make reference here to Paul Hawkins' Drawdown. And if you're not, I might have that name wrong because I struggled with it, but I hope I have it right. Drawdown. If you haven't read or watched Drawdown, I'd like to encourage you to do so. One of the points in Drawdown is coastal resiliency and working with our wetlands. And if you look behind me, you'll see straight across there is unbulkheaded marsh there. And you'll also see on the sides that there is bulkhead. Southampton Town has not built any new bulkhead. The trustees have not permitted any new bulkhead in more than 30 years. People and others are allowed to replace their bulkhead. But what we're really working towards with living shorelines, it's a new concept, it's not new, it's a new term, but we're hoping to either have some people move their bulkheads or look to using the marsh that's already in front of their properties to create more resiliency in storms. The marsh grass absorbs some of the wave energy, and the marsh itself absorbs some of the water as the tides come in and are higher and more impactful. So thank you again to all of you who made this day possible, and I so appreciate being here on behalf of the Southampton Town Trustees. And I'd also just like to, thank you to all of you.